Welcome to Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. I'm Julia Lilkindy. Hi, Senator. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. I'm doing very well. Thank you.
I want to continue our discussion from last week about the governor's vision for New York. Yesterday, he gave his budget message. So you want to tell us what you feel about that?
Well, I think it was contradictory in so many different ways, and it was more about how do we divert attention to the problems of the state of New York by blaming the federal government? And, you know, that never works. In my mind, it's just abdicating your responsibility. For example, he spoke so much about the federal tax code, the changes that hurt New Yorkers, and that because of that, New Yorkers are going to be paying more taxes because they don't have some, everybody's going to lose these deductions. Well, first of all, you got to check his facts, because virtually everybody that has incomes below $200,000 are not going to be affected. How many people pay taxes, the average person pay taxes $20,000-$30,000 range, you know? So it's going to affect some people, but there's other things that counteract some of those losses, including a higher standard deduction and so forth and so on. So he overstated the effect of what the federal government has done in their tax revisions. That's point one. Number two, if the problem is that we're going to be taxed more because the federal government did all these dastardly deeds, how in God's name can you justify more taxes? And he had $1 billion more taxes that he's, or fees that he wants to impose on New Yorkers.
Revenue raisers.
He didn't mention taxes at all. You know, we got to be, we got to just avoid it, you know, divert attention to what it really is, revenue raisers, and which is really taxes or fees. So that's contradictory. Secondly, his solution is twofold because of the dastardly deeds of the federal government. Number one, we're going to sue the federal government. Now, I would like to find one attorney worth his or her salt that could tell me that that lawsuit's going to be effective, that you could sue the federal government based upon what all the representatives throughout the country legislated for the tax code of the states in the country. And it's just not possible. It's sort of like saying, sort of like maybe a county executive suing the governor for making for unfunded mandates, because you're telling us to do these things and then you're not giving us money, so we're going to sue you. Now, he would mock that, but he's using this concept of a suit as some reality, and it's not. Then the other solutions were, number one, a payroll tax.
Right.
It's going to make up, we're going to replace the income tax. Now, that's going to be something to behold. As you can tell, there was no details whatsoever. Mm-hmm. But just a couple of facts would pretty much indicate how this is going nowhere. Number one is that not everybody receives a check from an employer. There's a lot of self-employed individuals that take draws from their companies or for their corporations or from wherever that they're receiving income from their personal services, and they pay estimated taxes. So how is that going to work? It's not the employer who's going to withhold more money and then end up somehow reducing your taxes. And the business community, even nonprofits, have come out in some cases to say that's crazy. That's, you know, it'll kill us, and we don't want that to happen. The other solution, and I put it in quotes, is charitable deductions. Now, you can deduct on your federal tax return gifts to charity, voluntary gifts to charity. What he's talking about is to create a charitable pool. So rather than property taxes or income taxes or whatever taxes he's talking about, because we're short on details, you contribute to this charitable pool, and it's going to offset the taxes that you otherwise would pay. So it would be deductible. Now, again, I want to see one tax accountant that can tell me worth his or her weight in salt, because there's always somebody who'll come up with something. But the fact of the matter is that that would be considered by the federal government a legitimate charitable deduction when it's really being done in order to offset taxes. So it was really bizarre. I was really sitting there with my mouth open wondering, you know, where he's going with this thing. But he may have accomplished what he intended to, divert attention to the blame on the federal government, who, by the way, is being blamed for people that are going to leave the state of New York. Well, the governor should probably be told by one of his aides that people have been leaving the state of New York.
Right.
And the reason they're leaving, it's too costly to live here, whether it's taxes, high energy costs, or a myriad of things. So, not one word about we've got to cut spending. We've got to make it more affordable to live in the state of New York, which was already causing people to leave the state of New York. So it was a bizarre message and a message that I didn't think made any sense. And I think once the public becomes aware of the details, they're going to see that, that this wasn't really a budget message. It was just buy me some more time so I can maintain my agenda to be the nominee for president of the United States of the Democratic Party.
Right. It was also really confusing to me, to like the average person. I think that a lot of that is very confusing.
Well, it was meant to be confusing, not take the blame. You know, I've said it when I've been going around the state talking to various people, and one comment I make always, and I haven't gotten an answer yet, tell me one time when this governor has admitted that there's a problem in the state of New York that he helped cause because of whatever it may be, and then provide a solution to that problem. He will never take responsibility, and he will never admit he's wrong and change direction. Well, now's the time to change direction. You don't raise taxes when the federal government is raising your taxes. You don't accelerate what's going on as far as people moving this out of the state of New York. You try to change the direction, and then he apparently is not going to do that.
The Senate has passed the tax cap, right, already last week?
Correct.
And unveiled an affordability agenda. Can you talk about that?
Well, it's really the opposite of what the governor's talking about. You want to keep people in the state, you got to make their taxes affordable, you got to make sure property taxes aren't continuing to go up. And but the part that really we didn't even get to that is as important, you just can't continually make that mantra or give the mantra that we got to cut taxes. You got to cut spending too. You got to cut spending. So and the governor didn't mention anything about cutting spending. In fact, he wanted to increase spending in several areas. And you know, if you're a household, and I keep making this comparison, and you normally took a long vacation at some magnificent resort, and your income one year goes down, you don't go anyway and just do it. And if you do it, you're going to be in trouble financially very quickly. You got to cut out things that you can't afford anymore. Well, it seems logical that the state should consider that same possibility, and the governor isn't even considering it.
There was one thing that he said, that it's an old stereotype, New York, high taxes, big spenders. It's not even true. I kind of laughed at that. I thought,
well, I would have laughed too if it wasn't so serious, the fact that it's not true. It's not true.
Exactly.
Every organization that does financial outlooks throughout the states and ranks them has New York next to last or last, or down pretty close. And you know, what he does is he picks and chooses certain categories so it makes it look better. But if you look at overall taxes, overall cost of living in the state, it's either us or California. And ironically, when he was talking about this charitable deduction that he's going to impose, he cited California as they're trying to do it out there. Well, if that doesn't tell you something, if California is your model on how to run a state, well, he needs a new model. So.
All right, so now the public hearing process starts up next week, January 23rd with higher education, the following day housing and workforce development, and then January 25th, transportation. So tell us what's to come. while you try to create this budget due April 1st?
Well, basically, the Finance Committee is going to be having hearings. I don't chair it any longer now that I'm Deputy Majority Leader and handle the floor of the Senate. But I'll be there. I'll make some guest appearances because I like to ask questions and to try to dig in deeper on what this budget is really about. And, you know, I mentioned something earlier, and I want to come back to it because I think it's important. I said you got to really check the governor's facts before you determine whether his solutions make any sense.
Yeah.
And during the State of the State message, he, as the underpinning for his concept that we've got to totally reform the bail structure in the state of New York, bail meaning you get charged with a crime, the judge sets bail, you got to post bail in order to get out of jail while the case is pending. And he made this impassioned plea based on a case where a young man was in jail for like 3 years waiting trial and ended up committing suicide. That was the underpinning. Well, the fact of the matter is the issue wasn't bail in that case. This individual was charged with a crime and was already on probation. And he was being held on a probation violation for which you don't get bail. So he makes this impassionate plea on a very terrible, sad, horrible case, but it had nothing to do with someone being held on bail because they couldn't make bail. It had to do with a probation violation. So I think I'm just asking the viewers, when they hear some of this stuff as the basis for why this other solution has to be arrived at, you got to really check the facts. And secondly, I'm not saying that there can't be improvements in the bail system. It's fine. But don't base it on some horrible case that didn't happen as a result of the problem you're trying to correct. And that was exhibited in so many situations during this budget presentation that they're really too numerous to mention.
All right. So people can watch these legislative proceedings on Channel 83, also streamed on nysenate.gov.
Correct.
So I understand there's a message you want to get out to New York pistol permit owners.
Right. There's been, I voted against the SAFE Act because I thought it was a very poorly drafted and a bill that really punished lawful gun owners more than it's going to stop any gun crimes. But be that as it may, it's the law now. So you have to re-register your, you have to re-license your, re-register by the end of January, January 31st. If not, there's an automatic loss of license and most likely loss of weapons as well. They can be confiscated. There's been some reports in the some newspapers and some blogs that the sheriffs and the state police are not going to enforce that requirement by the end of the month. Well, I would not rely on that. If I would, I already have re-registered in my individual case, but I wouldn't go on that because the law talks about an automatic loss of a license. And you can't, any elected official can't say, well, we're not going to enforce it. I mean, maybe that's the way you know, some people do in government, but that doesn't excuse you from being consistent with what the law requires. So I would tell everybody, no matter who says what, I would register before the 31st because you never know what's going to happen and whether or not they have even the authority to say we're not going to enforce these gun laws. And we in the Senate have got a bill that would give 2 months more to the lawful gun owners to re-register so it would go through March rather than the end of January. That hasn't passed yet, and certainly it hasn't gone through the assembly yet. So that's our remedy, and we're trying to push that as well. But in the meantime, if nothing changes legally, then you really better be safe rather than very sorry later on.
And registering is through the New York State Police Department.
State Police, correct.
Troopers.
It's on their website, and it's very easy to do. Because I've already done it, and I've gone through it, and it's something that it's burdensome in the sense that why do we have to do that? We had to do that because we a ill-advised law passed, but it's still the law. It's a law that I voted, a bill that I voted against.
Right. Thank you so much for your time, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.